Digital Foundry is proudly sponsored by Omen's new wireless range of mice, keyboards, and headsets.
Our plan. You're not an apprentice anymore, boy. So study your surroundings. Devise your own plan. I'm not here to hold your hand.
The classic benchmark sequence from Assassin's Creed Unity, running at 60 FPS on a console. Pretty awesome stuff. And to talk about this today, I'm joined by my friend and colleague, John Lindemann. How you doing there, John?
I'm doing good, and I'm in awe. Like, this is the smoothest Unity... Wait, this isn't Unity. This is Assassin's Creed Unity. and yeah, we've never seen it looking like this on a console.
Xbox Series X series just kind of powering through to put this game at 60 FPS. It's pretty awesome.
So I guess people are probably wondering, like, why are we covering this and what's the story here? Because, you know, in general, you're not going to get a magically unlocked frame rate like this. You're not just going to pop in an old game, get to 60 frames per second, because AC Unity in its current form, it's capped at 30 frames per second. But it was not in its original build. And this is weird because clearly they had a difficult time getting this game out the door. The initial version had some issues for sure. And one of the strangest decisions of that time, and I'm not even sure where it came from, was to just leave the frame rate uncapped. Especially because this is a game that was notorious for barely being able to hit 30 frames per second. And that was the controversy when it launched, was that on both PS4 and Xbox One, it was, you know, often in the mid to low 20s when exploring these massive crowd scenes. Which, to be fair, that's how all the other previous Assassin's Creed games ran on last generation consoles, you know. So it wasn't actually that much worse. It just kind of, you know, console wars. It was pretty bad for what you'd expect from a new generation.
Yeah, it was like the expectations almost.
Exactly. But here we are. It's this original disc version of the game, uncapped frame rate, finally just installing it straight from the disc and using it without a patch. We get this. And Alex, I think people might want to understand better, like, why it's like that, because we've already seen some improvement with Xbox One X, but this takes it much further.
So this game was both CPU and GPU limited when it came out originally on PS4 and Xbox One. Hence why you could have GPU limited scenes, like in cutscenes, when this really wonderful looking bokeh depth of field comes up on screen and it's sub 30 FPS. Xbox One X here in back compat mode doesn't have access to the full near 6 teraflops of GPU power, rather has around 3 teraflops of power to take advantage of, so it'll get around a 2x performance advantage in such GPU limited scenes like these cutscenes here. So if the Xbox One is like 24 FPS, it'll be around 48 or so on Xbox One X. CPU limited scenes like the ones you see outdoors in the city, you're going to see that differential between the two machines, like Xbox One X and Xbox One, going down, and the Xbox One will actually be spending a lot of time below 30 FPS. This game was just thrashing the GPU and CPU of those current gen consoles at that time, the Xbox One and the PS4. Xbox Series X, on the other hand, just comes in with 12 teraflops of GCN power because they kind of have like a back compat mode for Xbox Series X that doesn't take advantage of the RDNA 2 functions necessarily, and has that full Zen 2 CPU to take advantage of.
Yeah.
And it just blasts every scene. There's not even a single drop frame in this entire 2 hours of footage we have here.
That's really the key there, is just, you know, especially on the CPU side, because with the patch, both PS4 Pro and Xbox One X could lock it to 30 FPS. They're just above that mark. It's just enough of a boost to get there. But obviously, now that we have the full power of the Zen 2, it can go all the way up to 60. And yeah, it's just kind of amazing. It really doesn't struggle at all.
Not at all.
And you've kind of broken this down into those two different scenes, obviously. GPU was especially heavy, like you said, with the bokeh depth of field, which was gorgeous, by the way. And they used it a lot. I think this was also pretty heavy even on the PC.
Completely. It is still pretty heavy these days if you like run it on like GCN hardware, which for some reason it runs decidedly worse on. I'm not sure why.
Oh, that's right. We did that with the Radeon 7 test, if I recall.
Yeah. you're also getting like 16x AF here too on Xbox Series X, which does help it out. But I think to kind of talk about this a bit more, why we're so interested in this is because AC Unity for us was, like, I think at the time, a next-gen game that went beyond the constraints of next-gen in a lot of ways.
Yeah, I think this is a game that, along with several others, it started development before the new consoles actually had hit the market, and I think perhaps they simply overshot the capabilities.
I'd agree with that there, too. Like, it was pushing a lot of things in a direction that gen could handle. Like, it revamped the whole engine to use physically based rendering, had like new cloth shaders that we would see in other games like The Order 1886. It had like this amazing depth of field, really great animation blending that I think is kind of not talked about too often, because Assassin's Creed games had, at that time at least, this more like automated running kind of mechanic. So they could blend animations really well there, and it looks really good when you're running around. It's not the best to control, I would say.
No.
But it still looks pretty great. That's the kind of stuff that they were doing that was kind of more standard to that generation of consoles. But the stuff where they were kind of pushing it over the edge was like the density of the environments and like the huge crowds, which I don't think we've seen really in any game to date since then.
Well, aside from, you know, Serious Sam 4.
Yes.
Despite all its faults, it does have that amazing introduction. I think the real thing here, it's they implemented this amazing baked lighting.
Mm-hmm.
And this took up a ton of space. It was just this huge amount of lighting data. And for me, this is the key here. They opted to, and I think we've talked about this, they basically opted to bake in fixed times of day,
yeah,
rather than allowing, you know, the time of day to change dynamically like some games at the time. And by doing so, they were able to perfectly refine the lighting conditions in each sort of instance, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And also interiors really benefited from this as well.
Really good looking interiors.
Exactly. So even if you go back today and you just look at the lighting, I feel it's a step above many other games this generation. And it's not just a tech thing. Obviously, baking out all that lighting data is a huge part of it, but I think there's an artistry to it as well. And
mm-hmm.
I've made arguments before that I'm not a huge fan of dynamic time of day, because even in real life, there are times of day that are, I guess, less attractive than others.
Also a bit boring.
Yeah, exactly. Also a bit boring. You can see this with professional photographers and when they choose to take their photos and things like that. I think I've said that the best times of day, the most beautiful times of day, are fleeting.
Mm-hmm.
The developers here very specifically selected these times of day to show off their new material systems, to really showcase what they could do with their engine. And I think it pays off in a big way. And it's something that games that came after Unity actually kind of lost.
I'd agree, actually. I think this game just seems very tailored for being such a, I would say, large, constrained, open-world game. It's very, we use this word all the time, bespoke. There's a lot of stuff that just looks really great and almost better than stuff we saw in later Assassin's Creed games. I think the material system looks so good here.
Yeah.
Like, the hair rendering on, like, this female character here is just still stunning, really,
yeah,
good-looking. I would expect that in a next-gen game to a certain degree. And it's kind of, because I think, like you're saying, this combination of artistry and a slight overshooting of the next-gen consoles. You know, this game still dipped below 30 FPS at 900p on the CPU and GPU on Xbox One and PS4 when it came out, and after patches as well. It scaled, though, a lot better on PC, which is why we, over time, over the years, Richard especially, has been using it in PC, GPU, and CPU comparisons, because it just works out of the box and it scales really well along thread and core count. And that's why we kind of really like it, and also just looks really good while doing it.
Yeah, and I think it's important to note that, yes, the disc version especially was somewhat buggy at release.
Yes.
But going back to it now, it's actually not as bad as you might have think, I suppose. In a way, I think it's that super low frame rate that it launched with and the really unstable performance that, you know, led people to think it was even more buggier than it is. I mean, it definitely has issues.
Yeah, like,
but it's not that bad. But the current version, though, all up to date, which we can't really sample at 60 FPS on consoles, but on the PC, I think it's actually rather solid. And it's, weirdly enough, I think one of my favorite Assassin's Creed games. It's the last one that I really enjoyed,
mm-hmm,
despite its faults.
Yeah, it's like the last classic kind of Assassin's Creed in many ways before it went towards a more light RPG kind of open world with more sparse environments.
Yeah, exactly.
That we would see in the later games. And like you're saying, this release, it's currently, the way we're testing this is on that slightly buggier disc version, and it's the only way you can actually have this game unlocked to 60 FPS And the reason why we're talking about this now is because, along with kind of celebrating this game after the fact, seeing that it does look and run better and it kind of does the game justice by running so much better, is that it's not enough. If you still play this, you know, first of all, this version of the game is very rare. You'd have to have the disc version of this game. And, you know, you'll have to deal with the slight bugginess that can still pop up with it. That's already rare. Then you have the fact that even then, the game's running at 900p, and it's going to have kind of not the greatest anti-aliasing, and some stuff doesn't scale very well, even though it's running much better. Like the LOD system in the game, and the textured LOD system, was designed around Xbox One and PS4 and early generation PCs. You could push that out way further these days, because it still kind of looks not too great when you have these large overview shots. When you look in the distance and you see like Notre Dame there, it doesn't look that great.
I tend to agree.
That's kind of why we think, at least, that, you know, this shows the world that consoles can finally handle this game at reasonable settings, running really well. Push up that resolution now, release a patch, go for a remastering effort, something to give this game the visual fidelity and performance that it deserves across next generation consoles, whether that be Xbox Series S, Xbox Series X, PlayStation 5, or even updated PC version to push out those LODs and things like that. Because this game, going back to it, returning to it now, there's so much wonderful artistry here that it was kind of lost at the time due to the performance and the resolution that it was running at. And now seeing it finally running well on a console, it's just like, wow, this is a great looking game, and we should really be seeing it at proper resolutions and frame rates.
Even with those flaws, I kind of feel like a nice artistic depth of field effect could help obfuscate some of the LOD issues.
Yeah, that's a good point, right?
And also, you know, like you said, stuff like the anti-aliasing, this was early in the generation. We have all these wonderful TAA implementations and other solutions to handling aliasing that simply didn't exist in the same robust fashion as does now back in 2014. So it would clearly benefit from that. But I think for me, one of the interesting takeaways here is that the game actually runs the disc version, basically. Like, you're still installing it, but you can play the disc version. And this is something that wouldn't be possible if you were playing on, say, an Xbox Series S, as it doesn't have the optical drive. So something like this, you couldn't even test it. And I think this is an example of why it's still valuable to have these original builds on disc. Sometimes you can do some cool stuff with it, something that wouldn't have been possible otherwise, and this version would be lost to time if it was digital only.
Yeah, which would be a huge shame. And I hope, though, that us making this video can allow for a historical revision or new reception of this game, which had a very negative reception at the time of release, but, you know, coming back to it years later on a powerful PC or here with this weird disc version just shows how interesting and cool and graphically neat this game was for the time when it came out, and hopefully a greater appreciation. And I would like to see a remastering or at least a patch for this game for next gen consoles. It looks really great. But John, thank you so much for talking to me about Assassin's Creed Unity here running on Xbox Series X at a flat 60 FPS, no drops.
Sure thing.
And if you did like this video, hit that like button and subscribe to the channel. If you're already a subscriber, consider hitting that little bell in the corner to be informed as soon as Digital Foundry posts a video. Or if you want to help us out, support Digital Foundry on Patreon to get years worth of Digital Foundry content available in high quality for download. If you want to talk to John or myself about Assassin's Creed Unity on Xbox Series X, write a comment below or follow John and myself on Twitter. As always, this is Alex, bidding you farewell und...
What do you normally say?
I say off he does it.
What you said.
Featuring its new warp wireless technology, Omen's PC peripherals allow for lag-free gaming. From the 360-degree audio of its Omen frequency headphones, the 180-hour battery life of the Vector mouse, and the 2.4 GHz connection of its Spacer keyboard, Omen has you covered for the ultimate wireless experience.